It's election night on CBS, and we have breaking news. CBS News has now made an estimate in the state of Maine. We are projecting that when all the votes are counted, Hillary Clinton will be the winner in the state of Maine with its four electoral votes. So that brings Hillary Clinton's total up to 218, Donald Trump 244, but still a very steep hill for Hillary Clinton to climb.
Again, we're looking inside those additional states and really the ones that have animated our conversation in particular involve Pennsylvania, Michigan, and Wisconsin, right? Do they have a similar electorate in those states, John?
Yes, well, they do. It's that non-college, blue-collar population. What makes Pennsylvania a little bit different, Pennsylvania and Michigan, the coalition for Hillary Clinton would have to be African-Americans plus those suburban college-educated women. In Michigan, she only won it by 5 points, college-educated women. So that's not a huge amount for her. Whereas in Pennsylvania, she's up by 14 points with college-educated women. So she would have wanted a bigger margin with that group. By the way, giving her Maine continues allowing the possibility of the screenwriters 269 to 269 electoral college tie. Mm-hmm. Since we just called Maine for Hillary Clinton.
The Clinton team and watch party was assembled at the Javits Center here in New York, just 2 miles away from where the Trump team was gathered. The Clinton team choosing this place because the Javits Center, which is a convention center in New York City, has a glass ceiling. The Clinton team wanting to make
symbolism there
that to place cracks in the glass ceiling. That has not occurred as of 2 o'clock in the morning on the east, and so the Clinton campaign chairman John Podesta has left the hotel, and here he is to address the crowd. Let's listen.
Thank you. Well, folks, I know you've been here a long time. And it's been a long night, and it's been a long campaign. But I could say we can wait a little longer, can't we? We're still counting votes, and every vote should count. Several states are too close to call, so we're not going to have anything more to say tonight. So listen to me. Everybody should head home. You should get some sleep. We'll have more to say tomorrow. I want you to know, I want every person in this hall to know, and I want every person across the country who supported Hillary to know, that your voices and your enthusiasm means so much to her and to Tim and to all of us. We are so proud of you. And we are so proud of her. She's done an amazing job, and she is not done yet. So thank you for being with her. She has always been with you. I have to say this tonight. Good night. We will be back. We'll have more to say. Let's get those votes counted, and let's bring this home. Thank you so much for all of you have done. You are in all of our hearts. Thank you.
The Clinton team had written a victory speech for this party on this night, and we have just witnessed John Podesta telling everyone to go home, that there will be no victory speech or concession speech from Hillary Clinton tonight, and that they're going to wait it out until sometime tomorrow.
Not only, Scott, had they had a victory speech planned, but last week it was announced that they'd had a fireworks display planned, and then that was canceled this week. I think they thought better of, well, maybe that doesn't send. They got hammered for announcing that. And then there was a problem, they said, with the permit, so that was scrapped. But it's so interesting. There was so much time spent on, I didn't see one interview with Donald Trump or one of his surrogates. If it doesn't go the way he planned, will he graciously concede? every interview with Donald Trump or anybody associated with him asked that question.
Well, but well, I mean, that was the question going into the night.
Yes. You know,
if it was close, would one of the candidates not concede? I think most people thought that would be Donald Trump.
That's right.
It turns out it's the Clinton campaign. I mean,
but
this
you're not
is
saying
not...
she should concede while there's still votes on the table.
Yeah, yeah. Exactly.
No, I don't mean that.
I mean the irony of what we're seeing unfold tonight.
Oh, yes. I mean, Bob, have you ever seen anything like this?
Well, I was the one who said yesterday, you know, the way this thing is going, the next thing it'll happen, it'll rain frogs. Well, it's looking like
frogs are coming.
Ribbit.
2004, John Kerry took a little while to get his to concede. So.
I assume what they're doing also is figuring out whether there's a challenge they can make if, in fact, they're losing and look at it. And they'll have a few hours to make that and look at the votes and say, here's a way that we can challenge it if we want to.
Yeah, I don't have access because we're all staring at the numbers, whether there have been a discussion about legal challenges in some of these states. I have not heard one at this particular point, but I think what we are seeing is these razor thin. But how extraordinary to have, we're not going to hear from Hillary Clinton tonight.
Yes.
One of the scenarios tonight was that this country would elect its first woman president as the 45th president, the first female commander in chief. We're not going to hear from her. I think the next question is, will we hear from Donald Trump?
Well, I'll bet you nobody from the Donald Trump campaign is thinking about going home. And I'll bet there are no charges tonight of a rigged election over at the Trump campaign headquarters.
Nancy Cordes is in the rapidly emptying Jacob Javits Center for us tonight. Nancy?
Well, Scott, it looks like people are heeding John Podesta's advice and filing out. You can see some people are crying. Some people just look kind of stunned. And I think the Clinton campaign itself is trying to figure out what to do next. Does Hillary Clinton stay here in Manhattan or go home to Chappaqua? If they say something in the morning, what do they say? I was digging a little bit deeper into the numbers in Wisconsin to try to figure out what's going on there. Took a look at the state's most populous county by far, Milwaukee County, and it turns out that the vote totals in that Democratic stronghold are off more than 100,000 voters from 4 years ago. Hillary Clinton won the county by just about as large of a percentage as President Obama did. She beat Donald Trump there by 32%, while President Obama beat Mitt Romney there by 34%, but she was just starved of the votes that she needed in that county to offset Donald Trump's totals in more rural parts of the state. So the question becomes, was it complacency on the part of voters there? Was it disaffection with Hillary Clinton? Was it a second-rate ground game in a state that the campaign thought wasn't going to be competitive, that they thought they had in the bag based on past Democratic performance there? It's probably a little bit of all of the above. They're not ready to throw in the towel yet, clearly. You heard John Podesta basically say, you know, let's find out what happens in the morning. But it's incredibly discouraging for a campaign that, if anything, was known for a superior ground game and had all the money in the world to air ads, to hire staffers in any state that they thought was going to be a challenge.
Nancy Cordes there. And John, this has been the central question tonight. Did Hillary Clinton underperform? Did Donald Trump overperform? What about in Wisconsin there?
This is interesting. So what Nancy was talking about is Milwaukee County on the eastern side of Wisconsin, and Hillary Clinton got 236,000 total votes that have been totaled right now. Barack Obama got about 100,000 more in Milwaukee County. So you could say, one conclusion could be, well, she didn't turn out the vote there. But then in Dane County, another Democratic county, she got about the identical number of votes that Barack Obama did. So did she not turn them out in Milwaukee, or is there some absentee? Is that what's the holdup? Because if she was able to do it in Dane, being off by 100,000 in Milwaukee is a little surprising. So that may be one of the reasons that Milwaukee is, and Wisconsin's still waiting to be called, even though Donald Trump has a lead of close to 80,000 votes.
Let's look at where the race is right now, and after that, I want to show you Pennsylvania, but first let's look at the nation as a whole. This is where the electoral vote stands right now, Hillary Clinton 218, Donald Trump 244. Now, that hasn't changed in a very long time because we are waiting for these states in white. The vote totals are so close in those states that we have been unable to estimate a winner yet. Now, in Pennsylvania, that is the largest state in terms of electoral votes still in play. Pennsylvania has 20 electoral votes. Have a look at this. Donald Trump, 2,000,886. Hillary Clinton, 2,000,810. So,
wow.
He has a lead, a significant lead, not a decisive lead. We have about 1% of the vote in Pennsylvania that has yet to be counted. And if you look at the third party candidate, Gary Johnson, 141,000 votes. Had those swung Hillary Clinton's way, she would be winning Pennsylvania, and that would perhaps save her chances to become the 45th president of the United States. But that is not the way it has worked out. Donald Trump now has slender numerical majorities in all five of the swing states that are outstanding. He only needs to win, depending on the state, two or three of these. Hillary Clinton would have to win nearly all of them. And with Donald Trump leading in those states, that seems very unlikely.
Bob, are we anywhere close to calling any of these really close ones right now?
We may be inching closer to it, Bob. John, do you have any insight on that?
I think we have to talk to Anthony. The Wisconsin had a record absentee ballots. Milwaukee County would be one where you would have probably a lot of absentee ballots. The fact that the count in Milwaukee is so down from Obama 12 suggests that that would be a good place for exploration with Anthony.
Anthony Salvanto, our director of elections, who crunches all these numbers with his team for us over there.
But Scott, have any of you ever seen a case like this? I know we've been saying this all night. We've never seen, where one candidate just says, I'm going home, while the others are still saying, wait, we're going to send Captain. Have
Gore
you ever seen
that.
Anything?
I mean, yeah. Gore did it. Well, Gore did it, of course, but then
and the other candidates stayed.
Remember, there was in Ohio, as I recall, in 2004, there were long lines, there were charges that the vote wasn't counted, and there was kind of a discussion about Ohio in 2004, which extended. In fact, I think I was covering the White House. I remember going up to the family residence at like 2 o'clock in the morning.
John Kerry didn't give his concession speech in 2004 till Wednesday afternoon. So this is not that far in the past that that this happened.
Well, I take it we're not going home for a while.
Apparently not. John Podesta says, we're going to be right here.
We're
technically,
up this
we can
late.
Just
I
do CBS this morning, right?
I know. I mean,
yes,
technically,
about to.
You got the table. Why not?
Yes. And it's CBS this morning, yes. We'll be on the air shortly.
Major Garrett is at the Trump campaign for us tonight. Major, I assume they're still hanging in there.
Oh, yes. Everyone's hanging in here. They're waiting for the moment. And when John Podesta, the chairman of Hillary Clinton's campaign, was shown on the large screens here, there were the lusty boos. You would expect that. But then the chant came, the chant I've heard 100 times if I've heard it once. Lock her up, lock her up. There is, I think we should point out, if there isn't a concession from Hillary Clinton tonight, and clearly there will not be, and if it drags on into the morning, there will be friction between these two campaigns as a result of Hillary Clinton's decision not to appear, number one, and number two, not to concede. Now, what is Donald Trump going to do with tonight's results? They're waiting for Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, and Michigan to be called and called definitively. They feel very good about all three states. I just received a text from former Governor Corbett of Pennsylvania, who said he is certain, based looking at all the results, 99.24% of the vote in, that Trump is going to win Pennsylvania. But the Trump campaign is waiting for those definitive calls, ironically, by the news organizations he heaps so much condemnation on when he's out on the stump. One other bit of irony. Those in Trump's inner circle find it rich, deeply rich in irony, that tonight, or this morning rather, at this precipice of the presidential election possibly leaning in Donald Trump's direction, it is Hillary Clinton who is showing hesitation about accepting the result, not Donald Trump. We all remember what ensued after the third debate when he left that an open question. The Trump inner circle finds that among the most richly ironic aspects of this early morning on Wednesday.
Major Garrett at the Trump headquarters for us. Believe us, folks, the moment we can make a projection on any of these races, we're going to do it, and you're going to be the first to know. But the vote totals are so close in these remaining states that we are unable to do that yet. However, we will keep trying on the other side of this commercial break. It is election night on CBS.
We're back talking about the extraordinary thing that's happening in this country, the closeness of the race for president. Joining me, Michael Gerson of the Washington Post, Ruth Marcus of the Washington Post, and Frank Luntz, who is a strategist. Let's talk about the Democrats. Mm-hmm. And also, let's talk about 2004, when you were working for George Bush, 43. And John Kerry, and there was a question.
A question about Ohio? He did not make a concession that night. We debated, should we give a victory speech?
Even though he hadn't conceded. And he didn't concede until a couple days later.
Which I'm sure the Trump people are debating right now. President Bush decided, no, let's wait. Let him do the right thing. He called mid-morning the next morning. Gracious call. And I expect that to happen tomorrow, depending on the outcome that we're going to see tonight with Hillary Clinton.
Ruth?
And if the numbers are clear, as we were talking about before, I think there will be a gracious call. Hillary Clinton has actually a terrific role model for that in Al Gore, whose concession speech is worth reading. It's very magnanimous, and it talks about the importance of helping the new president govern the country. That's the tone, if the results are clear, that Hillary Clinton and the Democrats should try to strike.
And I think that the brawl is going to come in Congress. Republicans look like they've only lost three or four seats tonight. It appears that Republicans will keep control of the Senate, so they're going to have the presidency, the House, the Senate. And the fight is going to be between Bernie Sanders and the more moderate Elizabeth Warren and Bernie Sanders together. And on the House side, it's going to be the same kind of tough
But since the Republicans, if in fact Trump wins, and if in fact the Senate is as you suggest, and the House clearly looks like it'll be that way, what can the Democrats do?
Oh, on the Senate side, they can throw a monkey wrench, and that's key. The House can do nothing, but the Senate has the capability of stopping everything that Trump and Republicans want to do by using Senate rules. So here's the question.
Filibuster.
I wonder how long President Trump is going to stand for that filibuster.
Yes.
That will be interesting to see. Look, I think we were expecting tonight to be having a lot of conversations about the future of the Republican Party and how they needed to regroup. We're going to have that conversation now about the future of the Democratic Party. Was this a failure of the candidate? She talked about how she's not a great candidate like her husband. She came with this email problem from the very opening moments of the campaign that never went away. Or is there a broader failure of the party to be able to speak to the kind of working class voters that Trump seemed to really energize?
It is a grand irony that we talked a lot about whether Trump would accept the results.
Right.
Now the question is not that.
Right. And I think Hillary Clinton's followers are going to have a tough time accepting these results, too. It's going to be difficult in this political system because of the depth of the bitterness of this campaign to accept the legitimacy of a outcome that's not favorable. But ultimately, Americans have to give a new president a chance. I have a tough time saying that, but I think that that's going to be necessary at the beginning of this system.
Okay, let's go back to Scott and Nora at the desk.
We have just learned that Donald Trump has arrived at his campaign watch party here in New York. Certainly premature to be making a victory speech because he hasn't won. This is the vote totals as we have them now. Hillary Clinton, 218. Donald Trump, 245. Certainly well within range of becoming the 45th president of the United States. There you can see his watch party. The folks at the Hillary Clinton watch party were just told, go home. Nothing's going to happen tonight. will revisit this in the morning. Clearly, the Trump campaign is not following the same advice. They're expecting one or more of these states to be declared in the next hour or so, and in so doing, he will go over 270 and become the next president of the United States. It is not over for Hillary Clinton. There are possible ways to win, but it's certainly not leaning in her direction now.
Donald Trump, who prizes winning above all things, is going to take the stage at almost 2:30 in the morning without a concession. We don't have any reporting about whether they've had a phone conversation or whether the campaigns have spoken. But inside the Trump campaign, we know that they're feeling quite good.
Well, they have plenty of reason to feel good. You know, Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, and Michigan, all the numbers are going in his direction. Minnesota looks like it's going towards Hillary Clinton, but New Hampshire is separated at the moment by a little over 1,000 votes. So that's four states that are in the balance.
There was a lot of conversation yesterday. My days are running together. Yesterday, the day before, when Donald Trump said, if I don't win this election, it will have been a total waste of my time and my money. And many people speculate that's not something that you normally hear from a candidate under any circumstances. And when Eric Trump was here, Eric said, well, Charlie, you asked a question. Right. He said, well, my dad is a winner. He only thinks about winning.
And
that's
Donald
clearly
Trump.
What he, yeah, that's clearly what is happening. What he was thinking tonight.
Donald Trump has picked up another electoral vote. He has picked up the electoral vote in the first congressional district of Maine. Maine and Nebraska are the only two states that are not winner-take-all. And so he's picked up one more, so that's 245 to Hillary Clinton's 218. And Major Garrett is telling us that we may be seeing Trump shortly at his watch party, and of course we'll switch right over there as soon as he appears on the stage.
I suspect many people are asking themselves, how long does it take them to count all these ballots?
I know, Charlie, I said an hour ago, what in the age of 2016 with all the technology, I'm very curious about what that process is like. Do you have any intel on that, John?
Every state is different.
The states are all different, as Scott said, and just the one electoral vote that Donald Trump got in Maine means the 269 possibility is no longer alive.
A tie now.
I don't believe that's I haven't run all the scenarios, but I believe in the one that was going to get you to 269 has just been undone by that one electoral vote.
We're waiting for the final vote counts in the states that will make the difference. We're also waiting for Donald Trump. We will be back in just a moment. It is election night on CBS.
Election morning.
And we're back. Gail King advises me we should be calling this election morning on CBS, and of course she's quite right about that.
No, I say election morning. I can't even speak. Yes,
morning. 2:30 in the morning in the East, and Hillary Clinton's supporters here in New York City at her watch party have all been told to go home. Donald Trump's, on the other hand, are all at his watch party, and we understand that Donald Trump is going to have something to say to them very shortly. But of course, you never know with Donald Trump, but it probably is not a victory speech because he does not quite yet have victory.
That's true. I mean, inside the Trump campaign, they are saying that there was an undercover Trump vote, that Mike Pence for VP was significant in their victory. Now, this is just what they're saying, that Hillary Clinton's floor and ceiling were the same, and that rally crowds matter, and finally, that they expanded the map.
As Donald Trump considers getting on stage here, you know, if he really thinks, and he has every reason to, that the numbers are going in his way, this is the first act of conciliation. Or the first act as a new president with a country that's obviously deeply divided, with a country that is partisan, a country in which people are going to be elated but also very scared. And this is his first chance if he honestly thinks he's going to win. How he handles this next moment, even if he doesn't declare victory, is the first test of how or if he's going to kind of try to repair the breach that's obviously there, even despite his historic achievement.
To that point, is he going to say in this speech that he wants to make America great again? Or does he want to talk about making America whole again?
Right.
After, and we should say lock her up.
And I mean, that's what the crowd is chanting.
Well, don't know.
And you know, the normal conciliatory things you say as a victor about your opponent have the slight conflict with the fact that he said he's going to have his attorney general investigate Hillary Clinton once if he's elected president. So that adds another a bit of context to what he may or may not say tonight.
No, Charlie, when you mentioned David Brooks's article earlier today, he said any decent society rests on codes of etiquette and share a moral ecology to make cooperation possible. It'll be very interesting to see what happens when Donald Trump.
I think part of the reason he may be coming over is that he has always felt a very strong commitment to his supporters. And this may be a sense to go over and say, she's gone home and they're not going to concede. I just want to come over here and thank you guys.
That's right. I mean, and each of them had to say something. It is 2:30 in the morning. You have to go over and say something, which is come back tomorrow, or we think we're doing well. And Donald Trump has decided he wants to deliver that message himself.
You know, since he's on the road, he could come by here. Hey, that's a little visit.
That's very close.
I mean, he's up.
Just at 53rd and 6th.
Knows the way. He's been here before.
And if you're watching our election coverage, Mr. Trump, please consider that to be an invitation. Proud to have you at any point.
Yes, we have room.
Here's a big table. Social media check for you. On Twitter right now, the term President Trump has 1.46 million tweets right now.
Already.
So at this late hour or early hour, depending on when you got up or when you went to sleep, that's what we're seeing right now. Also, a tweet from Kellyanne Conway responding to a tweet from a reporter, which reads, "Stunned that Hillary Clinton did not concede. If real Donald Trump pulled that, people would go bananas." And Kellyanne Conway responds, "This is the truest tweet ever." So,
well, no need to concede yet, because this race isn't quite over. We will have more for you in just a minute as CBS News coverage continues. Good morning. It is election morning here.
Good morning.
On CBS, and we are still waiting for a few states to come in. Donald Trump is leading by small margins in these states. If he wins two or three of them now, he will be the 45th president of the United States. Let's have a look at Wisconsin. This is one of the states that we are projecting is leaning Donald Trump's way, but we're unable to project him as the winner because the vote totals just aren't there yet. There he is, 1,385,000 votes. Hillary Clinton, 1,309,000 votes. And it is the same story in Pennsylvania, Michigan, Arizona, New Hampshire, very close vote totals. Let's have a look at Pennsylvania. There is Donald Trump with 2.9 million, Hillary Clinton with a little over 2.8 million. 97% of the votes counted in Pennsylvania, just a few outstanding, still a little bit too close to call. Pennsylvania is the largest state outstanding at this point, and if Pennsylvania goes Donald Trump's way, which it appears to be heading that way, it is all but over for Hillary Clinton tonight. Michigan as well. You see the numbers for Michigan.
It is. And yet our decision desk still has Pennsylvania and Michigan as toss-ups at this hour, as well as New Hampshire. Wisconsin is leaning Republican, and Arizona is leaning Republican, but Michigan, New Hampshire, Pennsylvania, still toss-ups, according to the CBS News decision desk, which we're showing right now, is they are all looking very closely at those numbers.
Yeah, the jackets have come off because it's like it's hot in here already all of a sudden. But, you know, I feel like someone needs to find Alanis Morissette's song, Isn't It Ironic? Because we started off the beginning of the evening, you know, all those hours ago, saying people are anxious, at least the wait will be over. By the end of the night, we will know something. And now as we sit here at 2:32 Eastern Time, we still don't really know.
Yeah.
You're looking at Trump campaign headquarters, their watch party tonight, and Major Garrett is there for us. Donald Trump is expected at any moment.
Yeah, Donald Trump is here. The top advisors to his campaign are beginning to make their way toward the center of the stage. Sarah Palin, an earlier endorser of Donald Trump, John McCain's running mate, is here inside the Hilton in Midtown Manhattan. We are told that Donald Trump will be out momentarily. We don't know exactly how many moments from now, but sometime in the very near future. And because there's not a concession from Hillary Clinton, he will not declare absolute victory, we are told. But talk about the direction he sees, and the numbers in all of the states still outstanding point very favorably in his direction, and that he wants to thank his supporters and talk about this moment and bask a little bit in the improbability of it all, but also tell the country that he's going to wait, see how the numbers come in, and when the news organizations declare him the victor at some point, and the propriety of a concession from Hillary Clinton, should it come, is carried out, then he will declare himself the winner. So in that sense, you can begin to see in the emerging possibility of a President-elect Trump a deference to the methodology, the long-standing process of working through a presidential election, a hard-fought one, and a closely contested one. But Trump does want to enjoy this moment and share it with his supporters and give the country a bit of a glimpse about what he sees and what he expects in the coming hours. And I made a reference to this a moment ago, but I really do think it's worth pointing out. Every day that Donald Trump gives a speech, he heaps scorn on the dishonest, lying media. I find it ironic that at this moment, what is holding Donald Trump back from declaring himself the next president of the United States is that very same media going through the numbers meticulously, accurately, probingly to declare him the winner.
Major, thank you very much. And we are not holding back, folks. Believe me, none of us want to be sitting here at 3 o'clock in the morning.
Sure we do, Scott.
Our decision desk is going over these numbers, as Major said, meticulously. We just want to make sure that we make these estimates correctly for you. And so we are still counting the last votes in some of these states that are so close. You know, what a difference 6 or 8 hours makes. The Hillary Clinton watch party early this evening filled up with high spirits. They were expecting to win. They thought it was going to be a walk, perhaps. The Trump campaign watch party was much more somber in the beginning. They were afraid they were going to get clobbered. And then slowly, as the night progressed, it dawned on both of them.
Right. Donald Trump with 245 electoral votes and Hillary Clinton with 218. And we should point out, as we also look at the popular vote and Donald Trump leading in the popular vote, that if we return to the map of the United States, we still have a number of states that are not blue or red. As you can see, Arizona, Minnesota, Wisconsin, Michigan, Pennsylvania, and New Hampshire. Those are battleground states. Those are the states that
Trump campaign watch party was much more somber in the beginning. They were afraid they were going to get clobbered. And then slowly, as the night progressed, it dawned on both of them.
Right. Donald Trump with 245 electoral votes and Hillary Clinton with 218. And we should point out, as we also look at the popular vote and Donald Trump leading in the popular vote, that if we return to the map of the United States, we still have a number of states that are not blue or red. As you can see, Arizona, Minnesota, Wisconsin, Michigan, Pennsylvania, and New Hampshire. Those are battleground states. Those are the states that our decision desk are looking at. That's why Hillary Clinton's campaign chairman said go to sleep. Donald Trump will have something else to say about that shortly. But these are the states why we're still sitting here at 2:35 in the morning.
You know, it's so interesting how evenly and closely divided our country is. You saw that popular vote. It really hasn't changed in terms of the difference all night long. Donald Trump has been ahead by 1 million votes out of 100 million cast, round numbers. In other words, he's been ahead by 1%, and that has really been the case over the last several hours. It hasn't changed much at all.
You know, I remember, Scott, when we assembled here at 5:30, seemed like a long time ago, of yesterday, and we looked for the word to describe what the exit polls suggested to us, and the word we just used and decided on was tight. It could not be any tighter.
And the other thing we noticed, Charlie, you'll remember in those early exit polls, was that a large percentage of voters, almost 40%, said the most important thing to them was change.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
And
the single most important thing.
Early in the evening, that gave us a clue about which way this was headed.
But it was also a little bit of a fooler, because then on judgment and who you thought could handle the office, it added up to the balance of change. So all of which were attributes that Hillary Clinton has won.
We've had an incredible team of reporters that spoke with people as they voted. We polled those who voted early, so we have a sense of the mood of the electorate that has been these exit polls. And if you look at sort of what happened with Clinton tonight, she underperformed Obama 4 years ago amongst a number of groups. 18 to 29-year-olds, she got about 54% of the vote. Obama got 60% of the vote. And it goes on, even among black voters. She got 88% of the black vote. Obama got 93%.
Nationally, so, Nora, were she underperformed? When she underperformed, did he overperform? Did all those people go to him? Is that what happened here?
Yes, and it also, the case may be, too, that the third-party candidate took part of...
You could see where the third-party candidate would make a difference, difference in some of these battleground states.
But his turnout in Republican counties was very high.
That's right, and she may have turned out in some places, but just not enough. I mean, Florida is, again, another good... is the best example. He turned out high, and then she turned out... she turned out, and then he turned out even higher.
She just never seemed to generate excitement. I think that is the thing we really haven't talked about here. But from the start of her campaign, it did not seem spontaneous. It did not seem, it seemed almost rehearsed, everything that she did. And I mean, the fact is, in the beginning, anyway, she was just simply not a very good candidate. I mean, she just didn't seem to stir up a lot of excitement, especially among young people. They were going for Bernie Sanders. They were getting excited about Bernie Sanders.
Young women were going for
Young
Bernie
women.
Sanders.
You never really saw that in the Clinton campaign.
I had a chance to talk to millennials for about 2 hours, a group of 30 of them recently. And one of the things that a Gary Johnson supporter said about Hillary Clinton is that people don't talk about the fact that she's part of the 1%. And for him, that was a big issue because he felt as though both candidates, major party candidates, could not identify with his own economic struggles. And that was something that was a deciding factor for him.
No, this evening is not turning out the way most people thought it would, other than unless you're a member of the Trump campaign. And I have to think that even they, John, have to be a little surprised by that it's come down to this close of a margin.
Well, I do know the conversations I have. I mean, they've always been very bullish. In the
they were always confident.
And they were always saying, you know, look at the rallies and look at our, we have a different way of trying to tap into the country, the real country, not the country as political operators in Washington see it. And I must say the political operators in Washington, in the Republican establishment, thought that Donald Trump was not going to win. So he knew something that they didn't.
These are live pictures of the Trump watch party. Donald Trump is there, we are told, and we understand that he will be taking the stage at any moment, and we will switch to him immediately when that happens. But we will first go to Major Garrett, who is there at campaign headquarters. Major?
Is it a Democratic senator?
Well, there's a roar of approval here you can hear behind me. We have been told, I believe, I can confirm, that Hillary Clinton has called Donald Trump to concede. We expect Donald Trump to come out here any moment and announce that to his throng of supporters in the Hilton Hotel in Midtown Manhattan. And that this moment, long sought by Donald Trump, long disbelieved by some in the Republican Party, everyone in the Democratic Party, and a good number of the American people still unsure about Donald Trump, apparently has come. Trump, if in fact Hillary Clinton has, as we are led to believe, called to concede, will tell his supporters that, tell the country that, and begin the process of moving himself from Republican nominee to president-elect of the United States. And the atmosphere, as you can imagine here, is elated, enthusiastic beyond belief, and A roar just went up right before I went on air, Scott and Nora. Ear splitting of the kind I've been hearing on the campaign trail when Donald Trump appeared to rallies with thousands and thousands of supporters, hoping this moment might come. In fact, it appears it has.
Now, we want to emphasize, Major, of course, that the word there is that Hillary Clinton has called Donald Trump to concede. We do not have confirmation of that from the Clinton campaign. And of course, the way the vote totals are right now, Donald Trump has not quite won the presidency tonight. He's at 245 electoral votes. He needs 270. These states that are remaining certainly are leaning his way. There's no question about that. But we were told earlier that Hillary Clinton's people were going to take the rest of this morning and wait until tomorrow morning to have any more to say about all of this. We are waiting for Donald Trump to come out onto the stage, and the moment he does, we'll be sure to go to him. And
I sure would like to know when she...
And Arizona, we are now calling for Donald Trump. CBS News estimates that when all the votes are counted, Donald Trump will be the winner in Arizona.
That's
that
11,
will give him
11.
Two more electoral votes. So that now brings our vote totals to Hillary Clinton 218, Donald Trump 256. He only needs to get to 270. And there are a few more states like Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, and Michigan that are still outstanding. But Donald Trump is leading in those states. So it may just be a matter of time, maybe just a few more minutes now before this is all done.
So all he needs is 14, right?
To get to 270. That's right, Bob. That's all he needs is 14. Pennsylvania alone would do that for him. Michigan alone would do that for him. And here comes Donald Trump.
Sounds like they just introduced Mike Pence. And his wife, Karen.
There's Mike Pence.
Mike Pence
and his
family.
Mm-hmm. We would expect Donald Trump next, and probably pandemonium to follow him onto the stage.
CNN projecting Trump wins Wisconsin.
They need to be down to four.
They have reason to celebrate at this headquarters tonight.
Now come on this side. Come on this side.
This is a historic night. The American people have spoken, and the American people have elected their new champion. America has elected a new president, and it's almost hard for me to express the honor that I and my family feel that we will have the privilege to serve as your Vice President of the United States of America. I come to this moment, deeply humbled. Grateful to God for his amazing grace. Grateful to my family, my wonderful wife, Karen. Our son, Michael, and his fiancée, Sarah. Our daughter, Audrey, far away, and our daughter, Charlotte. I could not be here without them.
And I'm deeply grateful to the American people for placing their confidence in this team and giving us this opportunity to serve. And I'm mostly grateful to our president-elect, whose leadership and vision will make America great again. So let me say, it is my high honor and distinct privilege to introduce to you the president-elect of the United States of America, Donald Trump.
Trump not having officially won yet, just shy of the 270 electoral votes necessary, but certainly the states that he needs to go over the top are all leaning in his direction, and the Trump campaign claiming victory. CBS News has just projected the state of Wisconsin will also go Trump's way. No big surprise there. That brings him to 266. Four short of what he needs to win the election, but certainly, as we said before, many of these outstanding states are leaning his way. There doesn't seem to be any mystery in this anymore as Donald Trump takes the stage in front of his fans and all of his campaign workers there at his watch party in Manhattan.
CBS News has not yet called the election as we are waiting for the vote to come in a number of states, but Mike Pence has just declared victory and introduced what he said is the next president of the United States. Donald Trump, who has never run for political office and in his first bid for office, he has managed to capture 266 electoral votes and is on his way to winning the presidency.
He became a Republican in 2012.
And here is Donald Trump.
Yes.
USA, USA,
thank you.
USA, USA.
Thank you very much, everybody. Sorry to keep you waiting. Complicated business. Complicated. Thank you very much. I've just received a call from Secretary Clinton. She congratulated us, it's about us, on our victory, and I congratulated her and her family on a very, very hard-fought campaign. I mean, she fought very hard. Hillary has worked very long and very hard over a long period of time, and we owe her a major debt of gratitude for her service to our country. I mean that very sincerely. Now it's time for America to bind the wounds of division. We have to get together. To all Republicans and Democrats and independents across this nation, I say it is time for us to come together as one united people. It's time. I pledge to every citizen of our land that I will be president for all Americans, and this is so important to me. For those who have chosen not to support me in the past, of which there were a few people, I'm reaching out to you for your guidance and your help so that we can work together and unify our great country. As I've said from the beginning, ours was not a campaign, but rather an incredible and great movement made up of millions of hardworking men and women who love their country and want a better, brighter future for themselves and for their family. It's a movement comprised of Americans from all races, religions, backgrounds, and beliefs who want and expect our government to serve the people, and serve the people it will. Working together, we will begin the urgent task of rebuilding our nation and renewing the American dream. I've spent my entire life in business looking at the untapped potential in projects and in people all over the world. That is now what I want to do for our country. Tremendous potential. I've gotten to know our country so well. Tremendous potential. It's going to be a beautiful thing. Every single American will have the opportunity to realize his or her fullest potential. The forgotten men and women of our country will be forgotten no longer. We are going to fix our inner cities and rebuild our highways, bridges, tunnels, airports, schools, hospitals. We're going to rebuild our infrastructure, which will become, by the way, second to none. And we will put millions of our people to work as we rebuild it. We will also finally take care of our great veterans. We've been so loyal, and I've gotten to know so many over this 18-month journey. The time I've spent with them during this campaign has been among my greatest honors. Our veterans are incredible people. We will embark upon a project of national growth and renewal. I will harness the creative talents of our people, and we will call upon the best and brightest to leverage their tremendous talent for the benefit of all. It's going to happen. We have a great economic plan. We will double our growth and have the strongest economy anywhere in the world. At the same time, we will get along with all other nations willing to get along with us. We will be. We'll have great relationships. We expect to have great, great relationships. No dream is too big. No challenge is too great. Nothing we want for our future is beyond our reach. America will no longer settle for anything less than the best. We must reclaim our country's destiny and dream big and bold and daring. We have to do that. We're going to dream of things for our country and beautiful things and successful things once again. I want to tell the world community that while we will always put America's interests first, we will deal fairly with everyone, with everyone. All people and all other nations. We will seek common ground, not hostility, partnership, not conflict. And now, I'd like to take this moment to thank some of the people who really helped me with this, what they are calling tonight, very, very historic victory. First, I want to thank my parents, who I know are looking down on me right now. Great people. I've learned so much from them. They were wonderful in every regard. I had truly great parents. I also want to thank my sisters, Marianne and Elizabeth, who are here with us tonight. And where are they? They're here someplace. They're very shy, actually. and my brother Robert, my great friend. Where is Robert? Where is Robert? My brother Robert. And they should all be on this stage, but that's okay. They are great. And also my late brother Fred, great guy, fantastic guy. Fantastic family. I was very lucky. Great brothers, sisters, great, unbelievable parents. To Melania and Don. And Ivanka. And Eric. And Tiffany. And Baron. I love you and I thank you. And especially for putting up with all of those hours. This was tough. This was tough. This political stuff is nasty and it's tough. So I want to thank my family very much. Really fantastic. Thank you all. Thank you all. And Lara, unbelievable job. Unbelievable. Vanessa, thank you. Thank you very much. What a great group. You've all given me such incredible support, and I will tell you that we have a large group of people. You know, they kept saying we have a small staff. Not so small. Look at all the people that we have. Look at all of these people. And Kellyanne, and Chris, and Rudy, and Steve, and David. We have got tremendously talented people up here, and I want to tell you, it's been very, very special. I want to give a very special thanks to our former mayor, Rudy Giuliani. Unbelievable. Unbelievable. He traveled with us and he went through meetings. See that, Rudy? Never changes. Where's Rudy? Where is he? Rudy. Governor Chris Christie, folks, was unbelievable. Thank you, Chris. The first man, first senator, first major, major politician. Let me tell you, he is highly respected in Washington because he's as smart as you get. Senator Jeff Sessions. Where's Jeff? Great man. Another great man, very tough competitor. He was not easy. He was not easy. Who was that? Is that the mayor that showed up? Is that Rudy? Oh, Rudy got up here. Another great man who has been really a friend to me, but I'll tell you, I got to know him as a competitor. Because he was one of the folks that was negotiating to go against those Democrats. Dr. Ben Carson. Where's Ben? Where is Ben? And by the way, Mike Huckabee is here someplace, and he is fantastic. Mike and his family, Sarah, thank you very much. General Mike Flynn. Where is Mike? And General Kellogg. We have over 200 generals and admirals that have endorsed our campaign. And they're special people, and it's really an honor. We have 22 Congressional Medal of Honor recipients. We have just tremendous people. A very special person who, believe me, and you know, I'd read reports that I wasn't getting along with him. I never had a bad second with him. He's an unbelievable star. He is, that's right, how did you possibly guess? So let me tell you about Reince. And I've said this. I said Reince, and I know it. I know it. Look at all those people over there. I know it. Reince is a superstar. But I said, they can't call you a superstar, Reince, unless we win. Because you can't be called a superstar like Secretariat. If Secretariat came in second, Secretariat would not have that big, beautiful bronze bust at the track at Belmont. But I'll tell you, Reince is really a star. And he is the hardest working guy. And in a certain way, I did this. Reince, come up here. Where is Reince? Get over here, Ron. Boy, oh boy, oh boy. It's about time you did this right. Huh? My God. Yeah, say a few words. Oh, come on. Say something.
Ladies and gentlemen, the next president of the United States, Donald Trump. Thank you. It's been an honor. God bless. Thank God.
You bet. Amazing guy. Our partnership with the RNC was so important to the success and what we've done. So I also have to say I've gotten to know some incredible people, the Secret Service people. They're tough, and they're smart, and they're sharp, and I don't want to mess around with them, I can tell you. And when I want to go and wave to a big group of people and they rip me down and put me back down in the seat. But they are fantastic people, so I want to thank the Secret Service. And law enforcement in New York City, they're here tonight. These are spectacular people, sometimes underappreciated, unfortunately. But we appreciate them. We know what they go through. So it's been what they call a historic event. But to be really historic, we have to do a great job. And I promise you that I will not let you down. We will do a great job. We will do a great job. I look very much forward to being your president. And hopefully at the end of 2 years or 3 years or 4 years or maybe even 8 years, you will say, so many of you worked so hard for us, but you will say that that was something that you were really were very proud to do. And I can thank you very much. And I can only say that while the campaign is over, our work on this movement is now really just beginning. We're going to get to work immediately for the American people. And we're going to be doing a job that hopefully you'll be so proud of your president. You'll be so proud. Again, it's my honor. It was an amazing evening. It's been an amazing 2 year period. And I love this country. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you to Mike Pence. Thank you, everybody. Thank you.
And that was Donald Trump, the 45th president of the United States, giving a conciliatory speech tonight, thanking his supporters, thanking his family, talking about the need to bind the wounds of division in this country, and saying our work is really just now beginning.
And thanking Hillary Clinton,
saying that,
Nora, in a way that we haven't heard before, that we owe her a debt of gratitude, and the time to heal has come, that he wants to be the uniter of all people. And he made a point of saying, I am the president of all people.
It was a very un-Trump-like speech from what we have heard throughout this campaign.
Well, we were asking whether he could be conciliatory and could he be magnanimous in defeat, and we found out that he could be magnanimous in victory.
So many times he would say, I can be politically correct, so absolutely politically correct when the moment calls for it. The moment called for a speech like that, and he gave it.
Bob, talk about now the challenges for someone as they transition from being a candidate to trying to govern and becoming and filling that office, that the awesomeness of that office and the responsibilities that go with it.
I think we're kind of in uncharted territory now. I mean, we really don't know. This is a totally new and different group than we have seen arrive in Washington before. And I don't think we can predict where this goes from here. I mean, it's different. This was a different campaign, and what happens now is different as well.
I think it's encouraging, though, to hear him say that he wants to reach out to all Americans, that the campaign is over, but the work is just beginning, and that he wants to do a good job for everybody. We haven't heard him speak that way before.
The first challenge...
He said he wanted partnership, not conflict, which was also something that, that we hadn't heard before. Yeah. Donald Trump is the first person to become president of the United States without having held previous elected office since Dwight Eisenhower, and he did it without the advantage of having won World War II.
Here's the immediate challenge for him. The rhetoric was basically about as good as we've heard from him and as you could deliver. He's going to have a Supreme Court seat to fill right away. Hillary Clinton probably would not have, talking to Republicans in the Senate. Merrick Garland, probably they would have voted him through. So he has a Supreme Court, and Supreme Court fights get pretty nasty pretty fast. There's that, plus the dismantling of Obamacare, the building of the wall. So his policy agenda right away is one that is going to require some massaging. So that'll be interesting where he puts his marker as he starts to talk about.
But we don't have a divided government. We have a Republican Senate and a Republican Congress.
But there's a filibuster in the Senate. They filibuster his Senate Supreme Court nominee, which will return the court to being a conservative majority, then you're going to have a fight in Washington.
And you don't know the other part is this is going to be, I don't care what you say, this is going to be greeted with surprise around the world. Maybe Russia's pleased with it, as we were hearing from our reporter in Moscow earlier this evening. I don't know how the rest of the world is going to react to this, except with surprise. They're going to find it hard to believe, I think.
They'll probably react depending on how he maintains the sense that he did in this speech, or in terms of the people that he chooses, selects him to be in his cabinet. That will be an indication of what kind of government he wants to have.
Major Garrett is at the Trump campaign headquarters. Major?
Well, a couple of things, Scott, and everyone else on the panel. Talking about governing, my sources within the Trump transition team tell me that as of last Thursday, all of the work set before that transition team had been completed, meaning they'd put together all the policy binders, had put together all the binders on passable cabinet and sub-cabinet nominations and appointees, had put together all the bindings on other political appointees that a future Trump presidency, should it occur, might have to have ready for the work to begin. So that work by the transition team has been completed and is ready for Donald Trump, now president-elect of the United States. So when Donald Trump told the country tonight he's going to get to work, he has plenty of binders and plenty of staffers on that transition team who have done the work for him to begin that process. A couple of other observations. Donald Trump has said from the very beginning of this campaign that he saw something in America in terms of untapped potential and terms of people who wanted to be a part of a rejuvenated American dream but felt that was no longer open to them. And he tried to speak to those people before he spoke to anyone else, and in a way that they fundamentally understood without any filtering from any other source. And even when controversies would arise and Trump's poll numbers would dip, or there would be some defections from the Republican Party over something that Trump said, those people who heard Trump first never left his side. And Trump was speaking to them tonight when he talked about a country to be proud in, a country that's going to aim for the best and never accept anything less than the best. Those words always resonated with his supporters. One last historical analogy that I've never forgotten since Newt Gingrich, a longtime Trump supporter, put before me several months ago. He said, to understand Donald Trump, you have to understand three American figures. Andrew Jackson, a populist president who toppled the existing order in Washington. Teddy Roosevelt, a Republican president who challenged the existing Republican approach to business and was a person of strength and projected strength. And P.T. Barnum, someone who relentlessly marketed himself for the benefit of his business and his image of himself. Newt Gingrich told me Donald Trump is a combination of all three of those figures, and his upside potential is enormous, and his downside risk is also rather sizable. And even in the last days of the campaign, Gingrich fretted openly if Trump, the downside, would undercut the potential upside. It did not. The upside now lays before the country, lays before Trump, and his transition team. Guys, back to you.
And Nancy Cordes is over at the Jacob Javits Center here in New York, where Hillary Clinton's watch party broke up about an hour ago. Nancy?
Well, Scott, the lights are now out here, and they've already brought out the heavy equipment to start tearing this whole set apart. And what's so fascinating is that for all of the talk over the past many weeks about the possibility of Donald Trump not accepting the outcome of this election, in the end, it was Hillary Clinton and her campaign chair, John Podesta, speaking for her, who came out here just after 2 a.m. Eastern time and told everyone to go home because things were still up in the air. And yet, a short time later, we can now confirm Hillary Clinton did call Donald Trump to concede. So at the end of the day, she is the one who has not delivered a concession speech, at least on election night. I'm told that there are a number of Clinton campaign officials still at Brooklyn headquarters, crunching the numbers, trying to figure out what went wrong, trying to figure out if there are any voting irregularities that they should examine or call attention to. Every single campaign aide I have seen here tonight, Scott, has been shell-shocked. They are totally stunned by this news. They weren't just confident at the beginning of the night that she was going to win. They were sure of it. There was no other possible outcome in their mind, not because they were cocky or being fanciful, but because all of the data that they were looking at was telling them that she was going to win. And that may be part of the reason that you never saw her here tonight, which is that just like her campaign aides, it was very difficult for Hillary Clinton to accept the news as well.
Nancy Cordes, thank you. And an interesting point that she makes there about as much data, polling, money, consultants, the whole Obama analytics team could not fend off what has been an incredible uprising for change in this country and for the unique person that Donald Trump is.
You know, it'll be fascinating when he starts to govern, because a lot of times when people would say, well, you know, you're supposed to do it this way and you're not doing it that way, you're doing it this other way, and that would create a certain sense of chaos, but he thrived in chaos. In fact, when things were too calm, he sometimes would create chaos to play, to turn the conversation on his turf. What does that look like when you govern? It may be the route to new success in a number of parts of Washington that have been clotted, but it's going to be an exciting ride. And there are going to be a lot of people who need to join in the team who may not know how to work or need to learn how to work in an environment where you've got a leader who leads in that way. And that'll be, we've never seen a chief executive who has led like that, in part because the office constrains you. You can't do it. But on the other hand, we thought there was a lot in politics that constrained him, and nothing did.
But you know, guys, he has said all along from the very beginning that this was not a campaign, this was a movement, and he made reference to that again tonight. This is a movement, he says, of hardworking people who love their country. And at least from the numbers we're looking at right now, close to 58 million people agreed with him that this is a movement.
But it was also a reaction, a reaction to a Washington that has ceased to work. The purpose of government is to improve the lives of citizens. Our government has been just gridlocked. It's been unable to do anything. I said earlier today, you know, it took them 8 months to approve funds to find a vaccine for the Zika virus.
Right.
This is a reaction to what didn't happen as much as it was a victory for Donald Trump and his people tonight.
And Charlie Rose has the insights of our political panel. Charlie?
Scott, thank you. You know, you can say that everybody who achieved the presidency, somehow it changes them. They can't imagine what it's really like to be there and to feel the burden of the office. And his first official act to accept the concession from Secretary Clinton, Donald Trump did it with some grace and respect for his opponent. Chris Christie told me on Sunday during an interview that he'd been working hard on the transition and that they had reams of books and had thought deeply about what they would do if the opportunity to govern came. I turn next to Peggy Noonan. Your thoughts?
I think his victory speech, which many people, including perhaps he, did not know he would be making tonight, was one that was worthy to the moment. It showed us a Trump who was graver than usual, who was more serious than usual. He said things like, no dream is too big, no challenge is too great. He reached out. I think he was trying very hard. I think he was being sensitive to those he understood he had to reassure, the one half of the United States of America that did not vote for him. So I thought it was equal to the moment, and I was glad to see its tone and hear its ring.
Michelle.
I agree he spoke in an octave that we have not heard thus far in the campaign, and with a cadence that we hadn't heard. This was perhaps his first demonstration of something as a leader that we hadn't seen before. He didn't throw an elbow, but he also talked about rebuilding, and it'll be interesting to know what that means. Is he just talking about infrastructure? Is he just talking about building the economy? Or is he also talking about unspooling the legacy of Barack Obama? Barack Obama's presidency has been consequential, and for some people, they view it as something that has been quite successful. And will he start taking apart key provisions of the Obama legacy? It sounded quite graceful, but was he also sending a signal that change is coming, big change is coming?
You know, Charlie, what I keep coming back to and thinking about Trump's victory and the implications and what we'll see going forward is that his coalition didn't just include working class whites and college educated whites on an activist level. It included men like Stephen Bannon, included people who would identify themselves as white nationalists, included parts of American life that have been suppressed for a very long time. And so looking forward, I think I'm a little less interested in sort of the mechanics of a Trump government and more interested in what does it mean that a candidate who in a lot of ways ran with a nod and a wink towards those people is now the president of the United States. What does that mean for African Americans? What does that mean for Muslim Americans? What does that mean for the groups of people that Trump has targeted in his campaign? I think that is the question that should be driving a lot of us going forward, because I do not think that we should take lightly that those facts.
The question will he govern differently than the way he campaigned? Often governing is someone, I think it was Governor Cuomo said, you know, governing is prose and campaigning is poetry. We will now see what the prose is like.
One of the things that Jamal said, though, is so important. In the governing is one thing, but also the messages that you send. We have this odd moment in America where we're passing the baton from the nation's first black president to a candidate who was endorsed by the KKK and did not denounce that.
Exactly.
And so, you know, as president, you send a message to the electorate about these key issues. And governance is one thing, but how people live and react on the ground is something very different.
It's about deed, not action. I mean, it's about action, not words, in the end.
Yes, of course. Well, let me sum up for me. I do indeed. I think we have witnessed tonight something epical and grave. I think it is the beginning of a new era whose shape and form and content are not known to us and are not clear, whose personnel and exact direction are unknown. But I think something huge and incalculable has occurred this evening. And I just wanted my last words to be, God bless our beloved country.
It was a historic night, and we all look forward to understanding how it goes from here. Back to Scott and Nora at the desk.
Brilliant conversation there, Charlie, and some really interesting points to amplify here. What is Barack Obama going to say? He has called Donald Trump unfit. He's called him dangerous. And what will this mean for Obama's legacy? It means it's in jeopardy.
On January 20th, President Obama is going to be standing next to Donald Trump at the Capitol watching him being sworn in.
Well, I mean, one of the first things that Donald Trump has said he's going to do is roll back Obamacare, which was the president's main legacy. And what other things are going to happen here? That,
as you know, and he's going to have to work with Congress, and there's some prioritization here that it's going to have to take place.
We're looking closer into the numbers about how Trump pulled off this historic victory tonight. Anthony Mason has those details. Anthony?
Nora, we're going to look at the three pillars of Trump's victory. The first was male voters, men. He won them 53-41%. He also won whites without a college degree by more than a 2-to-1 margin, 67-28%. And voters told us that the quality they wanted most in their candidate today was a candidate who could bring about change. And among those voters, Donald Trump won 83%. So huge landslide in that category there, the most important quality. And finally, there was a lot of talk after the Access Hollywood tape and a lot of leading Republicans pulled back their endorsement from Donald Trump that Republicans might, in fact, flee from him. Well, that didn't turn out to be the case today. He won 9 out of 10 Republican voters. They came home to Donald Trump. Gail?
He certainly did, Anthony. Continuing that conversation, according to the exit poll, 7 in 10 said that they were dissatisfied with the federal government. 58% of those who made that comment went with Donald Trump. 36% of those went with Hillary Clinton. It goes back to what he said from when he started this campaign. It's not a campaign, it's a movement of people. And that certainly bore itself out today.
Now everybody knows it's only the electoral vote that counts, and Donald Trump has won that decisively tonight. But have a look at how divided the country is. Let's look at the popular vote. 57,600,000 for Donald Trump, 56,855,000 for Hillary Clinton. That's the popular vote as it's being counted right now. Donald Trump wins in the popular vote, yes indeed, but it's only about 1% difference between the two.
Yes, and you know, we've seen Donald Trump give a conciliatory sort of the right pitch in his speech, but those 56 million who voted for Hillary Clinton, there are a lot of them who believe that he came to this position by playing on racial fears. He was for 5 years the chief advocate of the idea that President Obama was illegitimate because he wasn't born in the United States. There are people on the other side of this who are not going to just accept this, and we will see what the shape of that response will be, and who becomes the voice of that response. You mentioned Barack Obama. He will not be the voice of that response, but who is and who does, and we have yet to see that part of the story play out.
Yeah, I mean, a couple of things. One is this is really a historic achievement in America. I mean, it's historic. Nothing like this has ever happened before. And secondly, you have to give him credit. I mean, he has achieved something that no one from the beginning ever believed he could do.
Elaine?
So on the point that John was making about these racial divisions, David Duke has tweeted, "This is one of the most exciting nights of my life. Make no mistake about it, our people have played a huge role in electing Trump. Hashtag MAGA, make America great again." Now at the same time, as Trump was reaching out tonight, I was reminded of the Latinos that I met at the U.S.-Mexico border when I did a documentary for CBSN, Latinos for Trump, who were among his most passionate supporters because they felt he was the one who was actually going to affect change in Washington. So they truly believed in him from the beginning, despite all the controversies.
Bob, what are you reflecting on this morning?
You know, I remember when Richard Nixon resigned and CBS News correspondent Roger Mudd was part of the panel. After that happened, and they said, "Roger, what's your reaction?" And he said, "You know, I think I want to go home and sleep a couple of hours, and I'll come back and tell you tomorrow." This was totally unexpected. I think, certainly, from those of us who've been covering politics and over the years, this is, I think Charlie is right. This is historic. But I don't think we can say right now where this goes from here.
Unexpected, not because of any interest in politics, but unexpected because of the polling. The polls were telling us. Polls done by many different organizations at many different times. They were all pointing in the direction of a Clinton victory.
The polls and the behavior of a candidate that people said was not fit to be president of the United States. So many people had found his behavior egregious, but at the end of the day, it really didn't matter. I take some hope in his speech tonight, though, that he said he wants to reach out, that he wants to build bridges, and that he wants us all to come together. I think that's a really good way to start in this country, because there's a lot of healing that needs to happen today.
If you look to your point, Gail, on the questions of has the right experience and has the right judgment, Hillary Clinton won those questions by gargantuan amounts and numbers, but again, it's not what people wanted. They wanted change over experience and judgment.
They're fed up.
All right.
Well,
yeah,
we change is what they will get.
It has been quite a night.
We hope he rules by fear rather, by hope rather than fear.
Well, his conciliatory victory speech tonight was certainly a very good step in a long, long process over these next 4 years. We sure are grateful that you stayed here with us all this time.
The raucous, who are you people?
Rancorous, sometimes raunchy election of 2016 now comes to a peaceful, if improbable, end. 70-year-old Donald J. Trump will be sworn in as the 45th president of the United States on January the 20th.
The Trump presidency begins in 72 days, fueled by what we know now is record turnout. Election coverage continues now on our streaming news service, CBSN, and there will be much more in just a few hours.
Really?
Yeah.
Who's gonna be
Charlie
here, Nora?
And I, right back here.
Wearing these same clothes.
Yeah. For Nora O'Donnell and our entire campaign 2016 team, I'm Scott Pelley. Thank you for being with us on CBS.
I am officially running for President of the United States.
I'm back!
When Mexico sends its people, they're not sending their best.
I'm running to help working families get a raise.
We will make America great again.
The American people are sick and tired of hearing about your damn emails.
It's weak to disparage women. It's weak to disparage Hispanics.
A man who can be provoked by a tweet should not be anywhere near the nuclear codes.
I could stand in the middle of Fifth Avenue and shoot somebody, and I wouldn't lose any voters.
Just remember, love trumps hate.
I humbly accept your nomination. Russia, if you're listening, I hope you're able to find the 30,000 emails.
I'm not making excuses. I've said it was a mistake and I regret it.
This is the single biggest scandal since Watergate.
There is no case here.
We're going to win at the border. We're going to build a wall. Mexico's going to pay for the wall.
You could put half of Trump's supporters into what I call the basket of deplorables.
She has tremendous hate in her heart.
What he says about me. I care about what he says about you.
I pledge to every citizen of our land that I will be president for all Americans.